Good afternoon and welcome to another episode of The Hunt. Hope everyone's having a great week. I hope those in the Northeast made out okay with the snow. As a Floridian at heart, I am still like a little kid when we get a good snowstorm. So I can't wait to get out of here and maybe make a snowman or start a snowball fight in the street. But other than that, I hope the weeks are going well. And for those tuning in for the first time, my name is Kevin Roth, Managing Director at Advice Personnel. We're a boutique recruitment agency serving the New York area for over 36, 37 years now. And this show, The Hunt, is a weekly series dedicated towards helping hiring managers and job seekers navigate through the wild world of recruiting. You know, we see so many different scenarios on a daily basis, and I'd say job searching is one of the most stressful things that people encounter. So this show is meant to give a lot of that insight back to the viewers and let you guys interact and really engage with the show. So for those tuning in, I encourage you, please use the chat box and the comment box, chime in. I love hearing where you're watching from, but also your questions and things that you're going through right now, especially if they relate to the topic. And I save time throughout the show to be able to touch on those subjects. I am laughing because I have Aime and Jenna both commenting on my haircut and the ring light. It is not a ring light. I moved a lamp over and turned it sideways. So we're making progress, but I am not yet at the professional level of the ring light. We will get there eventually. So in terms of today's episode, again, for those tuning in, today's show is all about how to set your compensation expectations at the beginning of a process. And we've all been there. You go through a job application, you're filling out all the fields, and you get to the end, and it always asks you salary expectations. And it's a major crossroads and a major dilemma for a lot of people because you're sitting there, and obviously you want to position yourself as high as possible. You want to really push the envelope to put yourself out there at a good number, set the tone high. But the problem being, if you go too high, the company might not want to meet you. So how do you find that perfect number? Because if you go too low, who wants to shoot themselves in the foot and end up, you know, setting expectations $5,000-$10,000 below where you really want to be? So it's a delicate balance of how do you find that perfect number at the very beginning of a process to set the right tone, set the right expectations. You don't want to scare away the company, but you don't want to sell yourself short. And that's what today's episode is all about, to help you through that process. So again, I encourage anyone watching and tuning in, use the comment box. If you're dealing with this situation, throw your own personal examples into it, and I'll do my best to tweak the advice and guidance specific to you. But we'll make this very defined and succinct and generalized to a few key tips that'll really help you through this. The first thing to really think about, and the first thing that I see a lot of people struggle with or really miss the boat, is think about how common is your background. Okay. Everyone wants to sit there and think that they're unique, and you all are. Everyone out there, you bring something unique to the table. But what you have to realize is, for the context of this episode, we're talking about that very first application you fill out or that very first intro conversation with a recruiter where you tell them what you're looking for and what your expectations are. So at that point, typically, all they really have is a good feel of your resume and your profile. They haven't gotten to know you on a personal level. They haven't really dug into your experiences, your projects, accomplishments. So we're talking at a very introductory level. How common is your background? How unique is your pedigree and profile? And that becomes important for a few reasons. One, if you're in an organization that has groups of teams that are very similar, so I'll use one that we're familiar with, an audit, and you work at Big Four, Deloitte, PwC, KPMG, and you are an audit senior, a 2-3 year auditor in financial services here in New York. And you look around, and on your team alone, you have 3 or 4 other peers that are at the same level as you, not to mention all of the other groups and all the other firms that do very similar work. So if you're that common and your background is that popular here in New York, then you want to set more conservative expectations, because what can happen and what does happen is, in that example, if you're looking for $100,000, and realistically, that's an aggressive number for you, and you should be looking around 85, 90, but you want to set the bar high and throw 100 out there, what's going to happen, what I promise you will happen, is one of two things. One, there will be peers of yours, because of how common your background are, that have the same exact experience, same resume, same pedigree, and they're looking for $10,000 less than you. Or you will be competing against people who have 1 or 2 more years of experience than you at the same exact salary. So now you have a company who's getting thousands of resumes submitted to them, a lot of which have the same exact background. And granted, I know you're unique and you bring different skills, and the argument is, well, I've done some different things and I bring a different attitude, personality. But at this point, we're only judging based on the surface level. You're setting yourself up for failure right off the bat. And I'll use a good example that people can relate to. If you're selling a car, let's say I'm selling a 2005 Hyundai Tiburon in midnight blue with a sunroof, because that was my first car and I will forever have love for it. Right now, the people that are going to ultimately buy that car, unless there's some weird Tiburon fanatic out there like myself, no one is specifically going to the internet to search for that 2005 Hyundai Tiburon. What it probably ends up being is someone who needs a car, needs a good vehicle, wants something a little sporty, but they're open-minded. They just need a good quality car. And there's a ton of options out there. So if you're pricing that at 20% above market, what Kelley Blue Book tells you, you're probably not going to get much success because there are so many cars that fit that general mold that someone could go for. Now, if you're selling a brand new Lamborghini Diablo with all the decked out things and it's the only one in New York, then by all means, you price that premium. So when figuring out how to set your expectations, again, I can't stress this enough, the very first thing you have to think about is how common is your background. And the more common your background, the more conservative you want to set those expectations, or at least put those expectations, because otherwise you're going to hit that wall where you're going to be competing against peers who are looking for 10K less, or you'll be competing at the same salary level for someone with two more years of experience doing the exact same thing you did, who's willing to take that same amount of money. And there is no company out there, if I'm stacking up two resumes of people that I haven't met yet, and I have one resume that has two more years of experience doing the exact same work, one resume a little more junior, nobody is going to first meet the more junior person. So that's number one. Think about your background and be realistic with yourself. I know you bring unique tools, but before you even had the chance to interview, the important thing is to give yourself an opportunity to get in the door. So if anybody has any questions on that, again, I encourage you, use the comment box, chime in. I see some of you starting to write in, bring those questions in, and I'd love to help you maneuver around these situations or just to hear your feedback as we go through this. So number one, thinking how common is your background. The second piece, how relevant is your experience for the position that you're going for? And this is a big one as well. You really have to be honest. And I speak to a ton of people on a course of a weekly basis that tell me, Kevin, I know I come from an accounting background. I really want to get into finance. I want to do more analytical work. Well, if you're out there applying to jobs and you're of that mindset and you're applying to analyst jobs where certain pieces of your background don't fit the skill set, don't put the same premium that you'd put for a job that is exactly identical to what you do. Because again, you're setting yourself up for failure. What you're going to find is you're going to be competing against people at that same higher dollar range who have much better backgrounds on paper. And you might be stronger. You might have greater personality and presence and intangibles, and you know you might blow them away, but you're not even going to get the chance to do that if you don't put a realistic number that gives them a reason to want to consider you. So the less relevant your experience for a particular position, the less in line your background is for a role, the less you should be positioning yourself for in terms of expectations, just to get that door open for you. And to use another analogy that a lot of us can relate to. Now, when I was looking for an apartment in the city, I remember my realtor, Kyle Jekalek, by the way, if you look him up, a special shout out. He's a great, great guy and has suits with his face plastered all over it, so you can't miss him. But when I was looking for it, I remember Kyle told me, Kevin, what are your list of amenities that you need to have? And I remember I wanted to be close to a subway. I would love to have a gym in the building. I would love to have a doorman. So there was three or four things there. So if Kyle came back to me and said, all right, I found two great apartments. One has all four things that you were looking for, and it's going for $3,000 a month. The other has two of the four things you're looking for. It's also going for $3,000 a month. Let's see both. Realistically, I'd sit there and say, Kyle, I hear you. Why don't we start with this one? This one hits all four, and they're the same price. Why would I not look at this one first? I mean, if I really don't like it, then maybe we'll check out the other one. And that's the mindset that recruiters are going through when they get thousands of resumes. They're going to have 10 people there. And if they see that someone has the same skill set as someone else and salary expectations are listed the same, they'd be crazy to start with you. They're going to start with the other nine that are more in line and at that same level that you're asking for. So be smart about it and think, how relevant is my experience? If I'm trying to pivot and I'm going into a field that's a little different than where my background aligns, you could be confident as you want about you'd be able to impress them in an interview. You're not going to get that door open or get that opportunity unless you set those right expectations. All right, so two really key points, and I hope these things hit home, and we'll go through a few final common thoughts as well. But again, we have about 4 or 5 minutes left to go through, so bring your questions in. If you're watching and you're going through this out there and you're sitting there and saying, I never know what to put in that line, and I never know how high to go or how low to go, how can I figure that out? Use this time now, use the comment box, and throw those questions at me, and I'll do my best to give you the best advice possible. All right, but in terms of closing thoughts and really thinking through this, there's a few main points to think about here. Number one, the biggest thing is you are not beholden to that number that you put in the initial conversation. The number you initially told the recruiter in the very first conversation with the internal recruiter at the company, and you guys had that 15-minute phone call and you just gave him a number, or the number you wrote down on that job application, you are not stuck with that number. You don't want to be in a situation where you throw a number that, and then all of a sudden you jump it up by 50% because you threw it so low to get your foot in the door. That's a shady tactic. I think it's called the foot in the door technique in marketing strategy. So you don't want to use that. But what you do want to do is use a realistic number, but be on the conservative side so that you give yourself an opportunity to get in, because that number is going to be something you can work on throughout the process. If you get through one or two interview steps, now they've seen who you are. Now they like something about you. Now it's not just your resume they're judging you off of. So use that at that point and start positioning and start sharing with them. I know, you know, I just want to revisit. I know I did mention expectations at the beginning. As I'm learning more about this role and the scope of it and what it involves, you know, I really just want to make you guys, you know, privy to the fact that I'd really love to be at a little higher number if we get to that point. And find opportunities to work that in. And that's a separate discussion. But the important point being, you are not stuck to that number. So don't sit there and overthink it and make sure you put that perfect high number, because you're never going to be able to get that if you shoot too low. That number is always maneuverable. So that's number one and the most important thing to think about. On top of that, it is much easier to build up and get a little bit more from a low number you started with than it will be to recover from throwing out too high a number right off the bat. Because if you put that high number on the job application, or you say it to the recruiter in that 15-minute intro call, and you go really aggressive and you go all in, I hope this session today and this episode goes to show that you run the risk of not even getting that opportunity to prove yourself. You could very well be worth that at the end, but you have to first give yourself that opportunity to get in. And to use Wayne Gretzky and Michael Scott's line that Wayne Gretzky I apparently stole from Michael Scott, you know, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. And I think it could go true that you will lose 100% of the job opportunities that you don't have a chance to interview for. So let's quote that, and me on top of Michael Scott, on top of Wayne Gretzky, in that order. But it's so true. You give yourself an opportunity to get in the door, and it is much easier to work your way up a little bit in the negotiation process throughout the process, once they've seen you and like you and see what makes you different, than it is to recover from throwing out a too high of a number where they're judging you based on your resume before they even meet you and you hit a wall. So that said, my biggest advice to you is keep an open mind. Don't think about this number as getting stuck. Give a number that's realistic, that could work. It doesn't have to be the number that is your ultimate aspiration, but give a number that's going to get that door open for you, and the rest will take care of itself as you navigate through the process. And when you get to the end stage and you got to negotiate your salary, watch the episode of The Hunt that we did last year that talks about negotiation tactics when it comes to the salary phase of the job interview process. All right. So with that said, I hope this is helpful for all the job seekers out there. If you have questions, again, please throw them in now. If I don't get to them, we'll get to them over the course of the next few days as I check the post. But two biggest things to think about when you're filling out that line in the job ad, or you're having that initial conversation with a recruiter: how much is your resume really worth just on paper before they have a chance to meet you? How common is your background? And how relevant is your experience for this particular position? And if you use those two things as a guiding point, rewatch this episode. I think you'll set yourself up for success, and you end up finding you get a lot more opportunities to work those numbers up and be much more financially successful overall in your job search. So with that said, this wraps up another episode of The Hunt. I thank you so much for tuning in. I hope you get value out of this. And I get those emails once in a while that someone used these tactics and they had success. So I love getting those. Keep the feedback coming. Remember to like and follow Advice Personnel on LinkedIn. We're constantly putting out good content like this. Reach out to anyone on our team if there's anything we can do to help with your job search. And make sure you connect with me and shoot me a message to let me know what you thought. And we'll be back next week with a brand new episode of The Hunt. In the meantime, everyone enjoy the long weekend. Have some fun playing in the snow. And we will be back next Thursday. Take care.